Dear students, in this lecture, I shall give you some examples of front of a class of diffraction. To begin with, I take the case of front of a diffraction at a single slit. As I told you in the last lecture, that the front of a class of diffraction is a class in which both the source as well as the screen are at infinite distance. That means we are dealing with a plane wavefront. A parallel beam of light, either coming from infinity or from a source which is placed at the focus of a lens, converging lens, will give a parallel beam of light. And this beam of light, suppose, is incident on a single slit AB, and such that the center of the system makes the image at the point O on the screen. So we will see that because of the phenomena of diffraction, the contribution of the plane wavefront which falls on the AB will spread in all the directions, and let there be any point P on the screen. We want to know the diffraction, type of diffraction which we are getting at P, whether this point will have light or not. Let the angle POB or now we just divide it into two parts. The one, the light which is coming before from the aperture to the lens, which will be a parallel beam, and to the point P. Now the angle which it makes corresponding to the point O is theta. So the direction of diffraction is makes an angle theta, which is P, and at the middle point to O. So this will be equal to angle BAC, means the light diffracted in the direction of theta. Let F be the focal length of the lens, and OP is equal to X, the distance of the point of diffraction from the central point. Then this will vary as we go away or closer to the central point. Now let the separation of the slit or the slit width is small d. From the geometry, you can see that the distance BC is equal to d sine theta. Now, we will get the corresponding minima and maxima with respect to point O. At an angle theta, the central point, at the point O, we will get the principal maxima. The intensity will decrease on both the sides of the point O, and let at P we get the minima. The geometry will show that this, for the condition of minima, is sine theta is equal to d sine theta is equal to lambda for the first minima, and in general d sine theta is equal to n lambda. Now, to find out the contribution of the entire wavefront AB at the point P, we will divide the wavefront from A to B into a large number of tiny small parts, suppose, and where n parts, where n is very large. So each point can be considered to be a separate oscillator, and which is oscillating and giving its contribution at the point P. Now there will be a path difference from when for different oscillators from the point A to the point P. So each oscillator will have a path difference. Let there are such n oscillators. So the contribution at the point P will be the contribution due to all such oscillators, which differ in phase by a small amount. Let the total, the resultant due to this, these all oscillators is OQ. Then OQ, as you see, that if will be the sum of all the oscillators from O to Q, as shown in the circle, in a segment of the circle between O and Q. Now, the resultant can be summed as 2 alpha is equal to 2 pi by lambda into d sine theta, where d sine theta is the total path difference. So the phase difference, total phase difference is equal to 2 pi by lambda into total path difference. Let it be equal to alpha. Then the amplitude, the resultant amplitude, which will be equal to will be given by A sine alpha upon alpha. I am not deriving it, you can see it from any book. In the case of Fraunhofer diffraction by a single slit. Now, the intensity, which will be square of the amplitude, is given by A0 square sine square alpha upon alpha square, where the alpha, as by definition, is equal to pi upon lambda d sine theta. As we saw earlier, 2 alpha we have assumed it to be equal to the total phase difference, that means 2 pi by lambda d sine theta. Therefore, now from this we can see the condition of maxima, the central maxima. Now for central maxima, we must have alpha is equal to 0, so that sine alpha upon alpha is indeterminate, and because alpha is equal to 0, so it will have the maximum value. That means the intensity of the central maximum can be obtained by, from the first principles, by limit alpha tends to 0 a 0 square sine square alpha upon alpha square, or which when solved will give this is equal to a square. So the amplitude of the at the central maximum is can be given by a0 square, where a0 is the entire amplitude, is the total amplitude of the entire wavefront. Now for the minimum intensity, we have a sine alpha is equal to upon alpha is equal to 0, and therefore it should be sine alpha is equal to 0. For minima, sine alpha should be equal to 0. And for sine alpha to be equal to 0, we have the condition alpha is equal to plus minus n pi. That means substituting the value of alpha, pi upon lambda into d sine theta is equal to plus minus n pi. Or the condition of minima is d sine theta is equal to plus minus n lambda. So there will be n minima. So considering this, the first minimum will be at d sine theta is equal to lambda, or we have sine theta is equal to lambda upon d. So the angle, sine of the angle at which the first minima is observed, will be at a distance plus minus lambda upon t. Other minima occur along directions obtained given the values of n is equal to plus 2, plus minus 2, plus minus 3, etc. In other words, the direction of theta of n minima is given by the equation sine theta is equal to plus minus n lambda upon d. So when d is equal to lambda, the special case, then in that case, for the first minima, sine theta is equal to 1 from equation sine theta is equal to lambda upon d, and hence theta is equal to 90 degree. So when the size of the slit is equal to the wavelength of light, then in that case the spread of the first the principal maxima or the central maximum extends up to 90 degrees. And as we increase the size of the slit, then the position between the center and the first minima will decrease. The width of the central maxima, as we see on the screen, can be given by sine theta is equal to w upon 2, where w upon 2 is equal to the width, half width, because the maxima will extend on both the sides of the point O, and therefore we have sine theta is equal to w by 2 by f, and this is equal to plus minus lambda by 2, or w is equal to 2 f lambda upon d, where f is the focal length of the lens. So this will be the spread of the central maximum. Now, as we have seen that there are n minima from the condition d sine theta is equal to n lambda. So for n is equal to 1, 2, 3 and so on, we will have sine theta is equal to we have the condition for minima, there are n minima. So if there are n minima, then there should obviously be n minus 1 secondary maxima. For the secondary maxima, they are given by alpha is equal to pi upon lambda into d sine theta is equal to plus 2n plus 1 into pi by 2. And this is equal to, or by which we can say d sine theta is equal to 2n plus 1 lambda by 2, where n is equal to eta. So these at these positions we will get the secondary maxima. Now, as we have already told, the value of n is equal to 1 gives the position of the first secondary maxima, and at which the intensity can be calculated. We can say 2n plus 1 pi by 2, that means this is equal to 3 pi by 2, and the intensity of the first secondary maxima will be equal to a0 square sine square 3 pi by 2 square divided by 3 pi by 2 square, or this is equal to I0 divided by 32. So the intensity of the secondary maxima is 1 upon 22 times the intensity of the central maximum. And similarly, the intensity of the secondary maxima will be equal to I0 upon 66. And similarly for all these, the third one is I0 upon 121, which you can see from the derivations equation number 15. So we see a distribution of intensities in the case of the Fraunhofer diffraction by a single slit. We have first a central maximum at the point O, and at the point where the phase changes by pi, we get the first minimum. Then we get the first secondary maximum at a distance of 3 pi by 2, then at 2 pi again the minimum, then at 5 pi do secondary maximum on both sides of the central point O. And therefore we get a diffraction pattern as we have already seen in the first slide. Now, what happens if instead of one slit, we take double slit, two slits? Then, for two slits, we have a picture like this. Let AB and CD, these are the two open slits, and both have every slit width equal to A, and the separation between the slits is equal to B. Now suppose there is a point at the, we see that at the point P, the contribution from AB and the contribution from CD, both of them, if they are equidistant from the point P, then we can consider them to be in the same phase, and at point P we will get a maxima, which is the central maxima. But at any other point Q, which is inclined at an angle theta with respect to point P, now the conditions will change. Here we see that if the in the case of a single slit, say AB or CD, any one of these, the contribution at the point P was equal to A sine alpha upon alpha, where alpha was equal to pi upon lambda into d sine theta, or A sine theta in this case, where A is the width of the slit. So total contribution is A sine alpha upon alpha. Similarly, from the aperture CD, the slit CD, the contribution at the point Q will be equal to A sine alpha upon alpha. Now both AB and CD, they will differ the light reaching from the central point of AB and the central point of CD will travel different distances on when they reach at the point Q. And the path difference between A and C, as we see from the picture, is equal to CE, which is equal to A plus B sine theta. So this will be the path difference. Now we can just analyze this situation by taking two slits of equal amplitude R, which are differing in phase by phi, and from the vector geometry we can see that R dashed square, that their resultant R dashed square will be equal to R square plus 2 R square cos of phi, or where this phi can be given by 2 pi, the path difference is A plus B sine theta, and therefore phi is equal to 2 pi by lambda into A plus B sine theta, and we have R square is equal to 2 R square into 1 plus cos phi, or this can be solved to equal to 4 R square cos square phi by 2, and therefore the resultant R dash square is equal to 4 R square, because R square, in this case R is equal to A sine alpha by alpha, so this will be 4 A square sine square alpha upon alpha square into cos square beta, and where beta is equal to beta, as we see from the phi is equal to 2 pi by lambda, therefore A plus B sine theta, therefore beta is equal to phi by 2 is equal to pi by lambda into A plus B sine theta. Now we can consider it, the positions of maxima and minima. The first case, when we have, suppose we take a principal maxima for which sin alpha upon alpha is maximum, then the intensity will vary according to cos beta. The intensity will be maximum for beta is equal to 2n pi. When cos beta is equal to 2n pi, because cos beta is equal to 1 at 0 or 2 pi or 4 pi or 6 pi and so on. So when beta is equal to 2n pi, we have pi by lambda into a plus b sin theta, this is equal to 2n pi. And so we have sin theta, a plus b sin theta is equal to 2n pi, or pi by lambda into a plus b sin theta is equal to 2n pi, and therefore a plus b sin theta is equal to n lambda. This will give the direction of the minima. Sorry, the direction of the maximum. This can be understood from the following figure. Suppose we have the central maximum. In the central maximum is the envelope, r is equal to a sin alpha upon alpha. In this there will be a variation in the intensity depending upon a plus b sin theta is equal to n lambda. So depending upon the angle of this beta, there will be maxima and minima in the case of in this case. So the total central maxima will be divided into three parts. In fact, this case, when we take a double slit, two slits, this is analogous to the phenomena of interference, because the interference takes place when we get we see the light coming from two different slits. So, and we know that in the case of interference, we will get equidistant lines, equidistant bands in a single envelope, and the spread of the first central maximum will depend upon the value of the aperture, and therefore we will have the positions of maxima and minima inside the slit. So therefore there will be different envelopes, and then the each envelope inside each envelope there will be different maxima and minima, which are analogous to the interference pattern. So these are the two cases of diffraction by one slit and two slits. What happens if there are a large number of such slits, say n slits? This system is known as diffraction grating. We see the ray diagram of a diffraction grating. In the diffraction grating, we have a large number of slits, one like AB, the other is CD, and then EF, and so on. And these slits are designed, this diffraction grating is designed by a special method, which is was developed by Wordsworth and relay. So in this case, they took a glass slide and a rolling machine. They rolled the machine, the glass slide with the help of machine, so that in 1 square inch, the number of lines goes to 1,000, more than 1,000, say 10,000 or 5,000, like that. And these, what happens that the ruling acts like the opaque zone, and the distance separation between the rulings is the transparent part. And in this manner, we have say 5,000 slits per inch or 10,000 slits per inch, and we have a large number of lines. Then we make a replica of this. Actually, materials like cellulose acetate, which in fact is a polymer, and that is a thin film of that is spread over this glass plate. So what happens? That becomes a diffraction grating in which the grooved parts, in that the cellulose is deposited more in comparison to the transparent part. And when the cellulose is dried and taken out, we get the replica of the slit. So in market, we get the replicas, the diffraction gratings which we get are the replicas of the original plane transmission grating. Now, as we see that there are these, the light will be transmitted from each element of the slits. Now, we take the same approach as we taken in the case of Fraunhofer diffraction by a single slit. In the case of single slit, just like AB, we divided the wavefront between A and B, or the entire wavefront, into a large number of oscillators which are differing minutely in phase from one another. And the resultant of one single slit was equal to A sine alpha upon alpha, where A is equal to the number of the parts in which the wavefront was divided multiplied by the amplitude of each such part, which is equal to, suppose it is divided into n parts, and small a is the amplitude of one part, so it will be na, and n multiplied by a, or which is equal to capital A. So the resultant amplitude due to one slit is a sine alpha upon alpha, where alpha is equal to pi upon lambda into d sine theta. Now, in the case of the two slits, we just added the vector sum of the resultant of these two. In this case, we have, as we see, a large number of slits. So, in the case of the large number of slits, we adopted the same approach. And the approach is, each slit is considered to be a separate oscillator differing in phase. Now, we see that if A is the slit width and B is the separation between them, the two slits will differ in phase by A plus B into sin theta, which we in this case we can say this is equal to Cn. So Cn or Bm, sorry, equal to Bm. And for the second slit it will become Cn or D O and so on. So now this Bm is equal to A plus B sin theta. So the part difference between the lights coming from two different slits is A plus B sin theta. Now we have to take the contribution of all. So this will be equal to the contribution of one slit, which is a square sine square alpha into sine square L beta upon sine beta, and this will be multiplied by sine square L beta upon sine beta, and this will give the conditions of maxima and minima for the number of tritings. And this can be you can see any book in which the mathematics is given. I am not discussing it in detail, except now I will be going for the the discussion. Now, as we have said that the path difference between the two slits of the plane transmission grating is equal to a plus b into sin theta. Now, we will have in this path difference, suppose if this path difference is even multiple of lambda by 2, then the point P1 will be bright, and the path difference is an odd multiple of lambda by 2, then in that case, say 2n plus 1 lambda by 2, then in that case the point will be dark. So a plus b sin theta is equal to plus minus n lambda. We will get the maximum intensity also, and for a plus b sin theta is equal to 2n plus lambda by 2, we will get minimum intensity. So therefore, we will get the, for the condition of maxima, sin theta is equal to plus minus n lambda upon a plus b, where n is known as the order of the order of diffraction. Now, so these are known as the principal maxima. These are the positions of the principal maxima, which we are getting from the condition sin theta is equal to L lambda upon this, where n is equal to 1, 2, 3, and so on. And therefore, we will get the pattern like this, the first principal maxima and the second principal maxima. In between the first principal maxima and the second principal maxima, there will be a large number of secondary maxima. And suppose if there are n, the grating contains n lines, then in that case there will be n minus 1 secondary maxima between the first principal maxima and the second principal maxima. We can discuss it from the condition. Now we will discuss the width of the principal maxima. Suppose the difference between the principal maxima and the minima, they fall at the angle theta and theta plus n lambda. So the first secondary maxima, which will be obtained at sine theta plus d theta, and this will be given by the condition a plus b into sine theta by plus d theta is equal to n lambda plus lambda upon n, because lambda upon n is the distance difference between the successive secondary maxima. And expanding and simplifying, we get d theta, this is equal to lambda upon n a plus b cos theta is equal to lambda upon a to the power, what is this, this will be lambda upon n a plus b cos theta, or lambda upon a, where a is the projection, a to the power 1, or a1 is the projection of the grating width on the plane perpendicular to the direction of the given principal maximum. Now, the dispersive power of the grating, we see that for the condition of maxima, a plus b sin theta is equal to n lambda, and if we the dispersive power is given by the function d theta upon d lambda. So therefore, we just differentiate it. We get d theta upon d lambda is equal to n a plus b into 1 plus cos theta. And this will be the expression for the dispersive power of the grating. Now, so the grating spectrum, the grating can be used to disperse the spectrum, just like that of the prism spectrum. We know that what how a prism disperses the white light into several colors, which comes which can be vivzi or violet, indigo, blue, green, orange, green, yellow, orange, and red. Now, in this case, because of the condition A plus B sine theta is equal to n lambda, so therefore, for different values of lambda, sine theta will be different, and therefore, a grating can be used to disperse the light exactly in the same way as a prism is used. Now, there is a difference between the grating spectrum and the prism spectrum. That in the case of a prism, the dispersion is more for violet and less for red. But here we see as a plus b sine theta is equal to n lambda, or for the first order, a plus b sine theta is equal to lambda. So, for larger value of lambda, sine theta will be more, and for smaller values of lambda, sine theta will be small. And that is the difference. In with this, the order of the dispersion is reversed. The second important difference between the grating spectrum and prism spectrum is that in the case of the grating spectrum, we get multiple orders, as a plus b sine theta is equal to n lambda, because the first maximum will be corresponding to a plus b sine theta is equal to lambda, the second will be a plus b sine theta is equal to 2 lambda, n is equal to 2, and so on. So we get multiple orders in the case of the grating spectrum, whereas in the case of the prism spectrum, we get only a single order. So in this way, prism spectrum is higher, more intense than the grating spectrum. So these are the differences. But gratings, one thing is more important in this case, the dispersive power in the case of the prism depends upon 1 upon lambda square. Whereas in the case of this, it depends upon the value of sine theta. A plus b sine theta is equal to lambda. So it changes as sine theta. So, in short, I have described the grating. Now, finally, I will take a few minutes to explain the phenomena of resolution and resolving power. Why do we are unable to resolve the images, resolve the two closed line objects? दो जो क्लोज लाइन ऑब्जेक्ट्स होते हैं, इनको हम हमेशा रिजॉल्व नहीं कर सकते. जैसे हम देखते हैं कि अगर कोई पेड़ नज़दीक में है, तो हम उसके हर पत्ते को आसानी से रिजॉल्व कर सकते हैं, अलग अलग दिखाई देते हैं. लेकिन अगर वही पेड़ दूरी पर चला जाए, तो हम देखते हैं कि वो सारा जो है अब पत्तों को हम रिजॉल्व नहीं कर सकते. तो इसका कारण यह है कि रिजॉल्विंग पावर, जैसे जैसे हम दूर जा रहे हैं, हमारी रिजॉल्विंग पावर कम होती चली जा रही है. एक्चुअली होता यह है, कोई भी ऑप्टिकल इंस्ट्रूमेंट, माना वो टेलीस्कोप हो या माइक्रोस्कोप हो या एक ग्रेटिंग हो या प्रिज्म हो या हमारी आँख हो, ये सब एक ऑप्टिकल जो इंस्ट्रूमेंट की तरह काम करते हैं, जिसमें कि लाइट किसी एपर्चर से गुजरती है. और अभी हमने देखा कि जब लाइट किसी एपर्चर से गुजरती है, तो जो उसके बाद गुजरने के बाद जो हमें इमेज मिलती है वो एक्चुअल इमेज न होके उस इमेज का डिफ्रैक्शन पैटर्न होता है। तो हम जो एक्चुअली ऑब्जर्व कर रहे हैं वो रियल इमेज नहीं ऑब्जर्व कर रहे हैं, बल्कि उसका रियल डिफ्रैक्शन पैटर्न कर रहे हैं। और हमने ये देखा कि डिफ्रैक्शन पैटर्न में सेंट्रल मैक्सिमा होगा, अगर माना हम फ्रंट ऑफ डिफ्रैक्शन की बात करें तो सेंट्रल मैक्सिमा होगा, उसके बाद फर्स्ट मिनिमा आएगा, फिर सेकेंडरी मैक्सिमा आएंगे। अगर एपर्चर बड़ा हो छोटा हो तो उस केस में तो जो है सेंट्रल मैक्सिमा और फर्स्ट मिनिमा के बीच का गैप ज़्यादा होता है। लेकिन अगर एपर्चर बड़ा हो, जैसा कि हम नॉर्मल फाइनाइट साइज हम अपनी आँख से देखते हैं, उस केस में एपर्चर काफ़ी बड़ा होता है, तो फर्स्ट मिनिमा और प्रिंसिपल मैक्सिमा के बीच में जो एंगल होता है वो बहुत कम होता है। अब मान लिया दो क्लोज लाइन ऑब्जेक्ट्स हैं, तो क्लोज लाइन ऑब्जेक्ट्स में क्या होगा कि इसका भी डिफ्रैक्शन पैटर्न बनेगा, उसका भी डिफ्रैक्शन पैटर्न बनेगा, इसका भी प्रिंसिपल मैक्सिमा होगा, दूसरे का भी प्रिंसिपल मैक्सिमा होगा, और दोनों प्रिंसिपल मैक्सिमा एक दूसरे को के बाद जब वो ओवरलैप करेंगे। अब डिपेंडिंग अपॉन द साइज ऑफ द सेपरेशन बिटवीन देम, दे विल द मिनिमा द सेपरेशन इन बिटवीन द सेपरेशन ऑफ फर्स्ट द प्रिंसिपल मैक्सिमा एंड फर्स्ट मिनिमा दे विल ओवरलैप, एंड द अमाउंट ऑफ द ओवरलैप विल डिटरमिन वेदर वी कैन रिजॉल्व द टू ऑब्जेक्ट्स क्लियरली और नॉट। सो दिस ईच इंस्ट्रूमेंट हैज ए रिजॉल्विंग पावर, एंड द रिजॉल्विंग पावर ऑफ ईच इंस्ट्रूमेंट कैन बी ऑब्टेन्ड विद द हेल्प ऑफ द रेले क्राइटेरिया ऑफ रिजोल्यूशन। द रेले क्राइटेरिया ऑफ रिजोल्यूशन इज दैट द टू ऑब्जेक्ट्स कैन बी जस्ट रिजॉल्व्ड इफ द डिफ्रैक्शन पैटर्न ऑफ इन द डिफ्रैक्शन पैटर्न ऑफ वन ऑब्जेक्ट द सेंट्रल मैक्सिमा फॉल्स जस्ट ओवर द फर्स्ट मिनिमा ऑफ अनदर, द इमेजेस ऑफ द टू क्लोजली लाइन पॉइंट ऑब्जेक्ट्स इज सेड टू बी वेल रिजॉल्व्ड इफ द डिस्टेंस बिटवीन द इमेजेस ऑफ टू पॉइंट ऑब्जेक्ट्स इज ग्रेटर देन द डिस्टेंस बिटवीन सेंट्रल मैक्सिमा ऑफ फर्स्ट एंड इट्स फर्स्ट मिनिमम, एंड द सेकेंड इज द इमेज ऑफ टू क्लोजली लाइन ऑब्जेक्ट्स इज सेड टू बी जस्ट रिजॉल्व इफ द डिस्टेंस बिटवीन द इमेजेस ऑफ टू पॉइंट ऑब्जेक्ट्स इज इक्वल टू द डिस्टेंस बिटवीन द सेंट्रल मैक्सिमम एंड द फर्स्ट एंड इट्स फर्स्ट मिनिमम। सी द इमेजेस ऑफ टू क्लोजली लाइन पॉइंट्स ऑब्जेक्ट्स इज सेड टू बी अनरिजॉल्व इफ द डिस्टेंस बिटवीन द इमेजेस ऑफ द टू पॉइंट ऑब्जेक्ट्स इज लेस देन दैट एंड इन दैट केस दे विल बी अनरिजॉल्व एंड इफ इट इज ग्रेटर देन दैट दे विल बी distinctly resolved from each other. We can see from it from here. In this case, suppose we have two objects. One say is at the position of lambda and another say at the position of lambda plus d lambda. Now we see that we will get the first principal maximum of one object at the point lambda with maximum at the point lambda, and the principal of another is at the position of lambda plus d lambda. Now there is in between lambda and lambda plus d lambda if the first minimum of lambda lies at lambda plus d lambda, or the principle of the first minimum of lambda and plus d lambda lies at lambda, that they are just resolved. Otherwise, if the separation between lambda and d lambda is lower than that, then they cannot be resolved. And if it is higher than that, then in that case it is clearly resolved. Here in this case we have written it lambda and lambda plus d lambda, because it, the same happens to spectral lines. Suppose I take a prism or a grating, the spectral lines, they are spread in the spectrum. Now the two spectral lines, whether they can be just resolved or not, will depend upon the what is the separation between lambda and lambda plus d lambda. That is, the two spectral lines can be just resolved if the principal maxima of lambda is falls upon the first minimum of lambda plus d lambda. So with the this case can be used to find out the resolving power of a grating. For a grating, suppose for the wavelength lambda, the, if the order is nth maxima is formed at an angle theta, when this the following condition is satisfied, and the condition is a plus b sine theta is equal to l lambda. Now suppose the angular separation between the maximum and that of the first minimum, the first minimum will be formed say at an angle theta plus d theta, and the condition of first minimum is given by a plus b sine theta plus d theta n is equal to n lambda plus lambda by n, where n is the number of lines in the grating, and also lambda theta plus d theta corresponds to a direction of the nth maximum, because this should be the maximum corresponding to lambda plus d lambda, and therefore the condition for maximum of lambda plus d lambda is a plus b sine theta plus d theta is equal to l lambda plus d lambda. And when the two equations, these 2 and 3 are simultaneously satisfied, the two closely lying spectral lines are just resolved. We simplify the above expressions and we get the final h lambda upon d lambda is equal to n multiplied small n multiplied by capital N, where n is the order of the diffraction and capital N is the number of lines in the grating. So we see that larger the number of lines in the grating, the larger will be its resolving power, and the second is that higher is the order, in the first order they can't be resolved. If they can't be resolved, they can be resolved in the second order, because then the resolving power of the second order will be double than the resolving power of the first order. So we have seen this an example of the resolving power. Similarly, we can find out the resolving power of the prism. We can also find out the resolving power of a telescope and a microscope. For a telescope, the resolving power is defined as the smallest angle between the two images formed at the objective lens, and the value is given by 1.22 into lambda upon small d, where d is the aperture of the lens. And in the case of the microscope, the resolving power is defined as the smallest separation between the two objects which can just be resolved. So there are these expressions can be found in any book, and because so I thank you very much for the patient hearing, and I hope we will meet again to discuss the phenomena of polarization as well as geometrical optics in the next few lectures. Thank you.